I'd like to welcome our infrastructure community to Autodesk University 2020. In a year of challenging times with COVID-19, I believe we can provide a valuable AU experience. My name is Theo Agelopoulos, and I'm the Senior Director of Infrastructure Industry Strategy and Marketing at Autodesk. If you're anything like me, you are probably suffering from a bit of Zoom fatigue, but we've taken the time to build a unique, fun, and entertaining content that you will hopefully find relevant and inspiring today. At a time when the world is looking at infrastructure to spearhead the global economic recovery, we need to accelerate the momentum we've seen in the industry's transformation to digital. I will share with you today three areas in which we at Autodesk are investing to help you along that transformation journey. They are connected data, resiliency, and design optimization. Whether you just got started a few months ago, or when the world transitioned to remote work, or you've been at the forefront of leveraging new technologies, we have the solutions your teams need to realize the promise of BIM with connected data and workflows. We've put together a series of on-demand content in which we lay out our vision of the future for infrastructure design, share product highlights, and provide deeper insights into the biggest industry trends, including digital project delivery and the integration of BIM and GIS. So please check out these videos next. Throughout these difficult times, I've been inspired by you, our customers, in your ability to innovate, collaborate, and deliver projects like never before. I hope that this content will equally inspire you about the exciting times ahead for our industry and how we will continue to be your partner in designing infrastructure for a better and more resilient future. So let's begin with the topic of connected data. We've spent the last two decades pioneering BIM, supporting improved project execution by listening to our customers and developing products that put your needs first. When it became clear that more and more design teams were moving to remote work, we accelerated our investments to improve our project collaboration experiences. We will continue to invest in our cloud-based solutions that connect people, connect workflows, and connect data. We, along with our partners, are offering you a complete set of tools and workflows to support you through the project delivery lifecycle. We've worked with companies like Esri to help customers better leverage GIS data to design in the context of the real world. We will continue to break down barriers between BIM and GIS to ensure we deliver more seamless experiences to our customers. Thanks to our new partnership with Origo, a leader in cloud-based capital planning, infrastructure owners can now also connect their capital planning workflows to Autodesk construction solutions. We are also developing our relationship with Sequent to enable geotechnical teams to better manage and share subsurface data. This collaboration will bring together above and below ground design and engineering processes to help our mutual customers improve their BIM processes and deliver better outcomes. At Autodesk, we are building a unique platform to help you take control of your data, improve collaboration across disciplines with the flexibility to customize your project delivery workflows. No matter the circumstances, you can keep working more efficiently and deliver projects on time and under budget. I always like to say it's not Autodesk that delivers the world's most innovative infrastructure. It's you, our customers. We build technology that enables you to do more, better, and less. Large infrastructure projects can be challenging under the best of circumstances. But the events of 2020 have shown us how our customers, with the help of our solutions, can overcome some of the greatest challenges on the most complex projects.
One customer in particular that I would like to introduce here today is the Link Alliance and the City Rail Link project in Auckland, New Zealand. CRL is a game changer to the city, and it is New Zealand's largest transportation infrastructure project ever. The Link Alliance needed to bring together 400 plus geographically dispersed designers, engineers, and supply chain to share over 100 BIM models. They achieved this in part by leveraging BIM 360 as their single source of truth. It's no surprise that given the complexity and collaboration necessary for this project, that they were awarded the AEC Excellence Award for Infrastructure Design. Please help me welcome from the Link Alliance, Daniel Jurgens, Digital Engineering Manager, and Bryce Gowden, Alliance BIM Manager, to discuss the partnership between private and public entities that brought success to the project and the Autodesk tools they use to facilitate collaboration, efficiency, and drive project delivery.
Hello, everyone. The intent of today's presentation is to provide you a brief overview of the integrated BIM delivery of City Rail Link. This is New Zealand's largest rail infrastructure project ever undertaken. My name is Dan Jurgens. I represent the design teams, and I'll be co-presenting with my colleague, Bruce Gordon, who represents the overall Link Alliance, specifically focusing on the construction.
The Link Alliance is the organization delivering the main stations and tunnels of the City Rail Link. The Alliance is comprised of construction firms, Pensée Construction Grand Projet, Soletanche Bachy International, and Downer New Zealand. And design firms Tonkin & Taylor, WSP, ECOM, alongside with our client City Rail Link Limited. The project is involving over 430 designers from 30 countries across 16 disciplines. And at its peak, in construction, there will be up to 5,000 workers on this project. The formation of the Alliance is a crucial point to the success of the project as we effectively work as a single team.
At the moment of use trains, the last stop into downtown Auckland is a Britomart transport centre. Train stop there and can go no further. This $4.4 billion project involves constructing two new underground stations at Aotea and Kay Road in Auckland CBD. We'll also be redeveloping the Mount Eden station and connecting these new stations to North Auckland Line with 3.45 kilometre Ford and Mine Tunnel. This underground twin tunnel connects the existing train network at both ends to create a downtown loop.
A key driver for digital transformation in large-scale projects is onboarding inductions, training, team upskilling, and custom support. Our team has developed and provided content for project onboarding and BIM software training, as well as individual support for the team productions. To date, we delivered 58 training sessions, which represent 154 hours of trainers' time. 1 year into the project, almost 350 people have been trained on BIM software. Although most of the trainings are being performed at the start of the project, we anticipate to be peaking before phasing out through construction and handover.
Now we're going to move on to computational design and programming, which has actually been really achievable due to the Alliance contractual model. We've used Dynamo for bore tunnels, cross passages, tunnel internal structures, and other complex models. The models are made up of thousands of different elements, all connected to each other by geometrical and design constraints. Major design changes that would have normally taken weeks now take days. Without this technology, updates to geometry would not have been achievable within the project fast-track timeframe. Computational design has helped to make the impossible possible. In addition to the Dynamo, we've created what we call LK Express by the Revit API. This add-in that we have developed is to streamline a variety of activities that we could not have achieved with straight out of the box with Revit. We have created 12 tools in total to automate documentation, modeling, data processing, and quality assurance. This video is showing the LK Express tool taking the alignment of the tunnel and applying the cable trays, ducting, and pipework directly to the alignment. To date, this tool has already saved us over 3,500 hours in design time. Moving on to common data environment coordination, and this has been one of the real key enablers of the project, has allowed all parties to be connected to the latest design information at any time via the cloud. Consisting of 7+ platforms that traditionally don't talk to each other, to overcome this, we've created a hybrid system, actually, of a variety of technologies, including Microsoft SharePoint for all project data, and firmly at the center of the stack for Revit and Civil 3D is BIM 360. This digital environment that we have created has been absolutely critical to the success of this project. If we did not have the CD in place, when the COVID-19 lockdown occurred, the project would have come to a grinding halt. Next, we're going to talk about federating the BIM models and coordination. Every week, the Link Alliance are creating and updating the federated Nevisworks BIM models. This includes permanent works from the design team, subcontractors, suppliers, temporary works designs, as well as point cloud data. We use this federated model to run clash detection to resolve issues, and we also create coordination reports for each package deliverable. These coordination meetings used to be face-to-face in Auckland up until March, when all travel was stopped due to COVID-19. Like CDE, without skipping a beat, we moved these online and they carried on immediately, this time via MS Teams. In fact, this has been so successful that when the COVID-19 restrictions ended in New Zealand, we still continue to host these coordination meetings online.
Construction engineers require accurate, up-to-date quantities to define methods and for their procurement activities with the supply chain. Quantity surveyors required for cost centers to build the budget as well as updating during construction. The sustainability teams require accurate quantities of concrete and steel for CO2 emission calculations, part of the environmental ratings for which the Alliance has ambitious performance requirements. Our team has developed a centralized quantities Power BI dashboard to serve each purpose, updated every month using the BIM models to reflect the latest design changes.
Another use case of the BIM model is the signal sighting assessments. The traditional approach is undertaken in a 2D environment, often relying on incomplete information with questionable accuracy, which does not account for design in a 3D space. The Link Alliance approach leverages Dynamo, Civil 3D, and Navisworks, and scan to BIM methodologies to undertake 3D signal sighting assessments. This effectively automates the process and enabling assessments to be undertaken within minutes. We can also undertake what-if scenarios in the early works, improving the safety of train operators, construction teams, and Auckland residents.
Safety is number one concern on the job site. Knowing that our construction activities will occur while the railway line is in operation, it is vital that train drivers know what to expect when passing next to the site. We are developing train drivers training simulation videos to help visualize ahead of construction state updates and communicate hazards and vigilance points. This video shows single line running configuration and the proximity of construction plants, workforce, and the public close to the railway. Tunneling works require a specific skill set as well as rigorous induction process, and this training requires adequate facilities or equipment. Virtual reality environments are cheaper and more accessible, although quite not the same experience of the training. The team is preparing a hazard awareness virtual reality environment for TBM and mine tunnels, and these are used during the induction process. This video shows the different steps required to prepare the portal area where the TBM will be launched. Developing these construction sequences require collaboration between permanent and temporary works designers, construction engineers, program team, and supply chain. And in the end, the sequence is used by both production teams on the site and by stakeholders and engagement teams with the public. Bringing data and documents to the job site is key for successful digital transformation. At the Link Alliance, we are using many ways to access the common data environment and collect and record information from the field. Using handheld mobile devices, such as tablets or smartphones, wearables, such as the augmented reality headsets, for which we are developing construction control points to support quality teams. We also brought for each site what we call digital totems. These are large Wi-Fi or 4D connected touchscreens protected by robust metal enclosures. Considering that we deliver this project in a fast-track design build environment, accurate capture of site conditions back to the design office is essential. Our survey team is capturing existing and as-built conditions using traditional stations, as well as terrestrial LiDAR and high-spectrum survey technologies. Survey outputs are imported back alongside with the design BIM models weekly to assess construction progress and perform tolerance checking.
Now it's time to talk about the handover of data to operation and maintenance teams. We've worked closely across the Alliance, including design, construction, operation, and maintenance teams, to create a structured and classified data set. We've also developed a robust asset tagging system that includes both an Alliance-specific tagging system, as you can see here on screen, but we're also embedding and including Unibus. Again, as we referred to earlier, the LK Express tool, again, has been absolutely essential in this process, as we're able to easily update and populate shared parameters in Revit and property sets in Civil 3D.
Working as an Alliance enables us to bring our project stakeholders together for a common approach to create an asset information model. Maintainers of the stations have different expectations than the railway maintainers. Being able to collect these requirements early in the project to ensure a seamless integration with the various maintenance management systems is a key success factor in the project lifecycle.
this project is becoming an exemplar for the digital delivery of large infrastructure projects. And it's actually been pretty amazing to be recently recognized for the Global AEC Award for Infrastructure Design. We're really proud of this project. Not only driving the development of the individuals in the alliance, we're also bringing the development of the entire New Zealand industry along with us.
Thank you, Daniel, for sharing such a great story. Although I've lived in the US as an Australian for the past 20 years, I love seeing the innovation happening down under. I can't wait to see how the CRL project progresses, and I'm equally excited to continue to partner with you on this journey. Daniel mentioned a little bit about sustainability and resiliency were kept top of mind throughout the project. So let's talk about the second pillar in which we're investing. Autodesk continues to be committed to developing tools that ensure a more sustainable future. Roads and highways are the biggest contributors to infrastructure emissions. 85% of those emissions are linked to material costs. Considering there are enough roads and highways built each and every year to circle the world 30 times over, this can have a tremendous environmental impact if built without sustainability in mind. Faced with this challenge, we are working with partners like Auris to bring sustainability to the road and highway industry. By integrating Autodesk Civil 3D into their digital materials management system, they are helping build sustainable and resilient roads and highways by factoring in local resource availability, environmental impact, and carbon footprint early into the design process. Leveraging these solutions can reduce carbon emissions by a whopping 50% or more. Additionally, capabilities in InfraWorks that simulate people movement and environmental conditions such as flooding and green stormwater are also being used right now by our customers to ensure future infrastructure meets design standards with safety, resiliency, and environmental impact in mind. These features, along with additional remote work and mobility simulation capabilities, have helped our customers ensure business continuity through COVID-19 and will continue to support them as they plan for a more resilient future. So far, we've talked about the importance of connected data and sustainability, but none of this will be impactful if it's not connected to the tools with which we design the world around us. Due to aging infrastructure, population growth, there is a tremendous demand for roads, highways, rail, and bridges that connect them through the world. To give you an idea, we will need to build 20,000 bridges each and every year to meet this type of demand. As we've made new investments in areas such as civil structures, we've developed more BIM-based workflows that begin with conceptual design and optioneering of bridges and ending up in Revit to produce detailed design models ready for construction. To drive efficiency, we have invested in creating tools that leverage AI, machine learning, and design automation such as Dynamo to reduce the amount of repetitive tasks and develop generative design processes with the goal of moving the industry to more outcome-based design approaches. We know that these tools will help our customers meet the ever-changing demand for more infrastructure projects at higher quality and reduced cost. We are excited that early next year we will be delivering additional terrain optimization capabilities for our civil engineering customers. The future of design is planning and designing with the end in mind. It revolves around optimizing design decisions by taking into consideration multiple design criteria simultaneously. I'm really excited to share with you an amazing example of how this is being done by one of our customers. Here to talk about how they used an outcome-driven approach by leveraging Dynamo to develop different design models of a runway for the Olympic Dam Airport in Australia is Aleks Radovic. He's the project delivery lead at BHP.
My name is Aleks Radovic. I'm a project manager with BHP. And we work at Olympic Dam, which is a copper mine in the middle of South Australia, which is in the center of Australia, in the middle of the desert. And one of the projects that we were looking at there, and we did many, many projects at the mine site, was upgrading our airport. And our airport was getting a bit tired. It needed to increase our capacity for our passengers. And we need to also increase our terminal. But we had to keep our operations live and running. And we thought it was just an amazing opportunity to use Gen Design to trial and see if we could actually deal with all the many variables for this project. Being the annoying project manager that, as many of my engineering colleagues in Jacobs say, you don't know what you're talking about, Alex. Leave the complicated stuff to us. Don't get involved. I said to them, look, what we need to say to the general design machine, I call it the machine, is this, as simple as this. We want a new airport. We need it to not impact any of our environmental, cultural heritage sensitive areas. Got to meet all our aviation codes, standards, specs, meet all of the safety requirements. It's got to deal with all of our passengers for the next 20 years, all of our passenger demands. It's got to analyze all of that, make sure that our current operational airport is not impinged in any way so that planes can land. We don't have to delay any plans. Make it cheap. I want it cheap as possible, please. And look at every option and provide me with the net present value. That is the best net present value. And so I said that, and as you can imagine, the room went very quiet. Everyone looked at me like I was an idiot and said, oh yeah, why not? Okay, maybe we can make a magic dragon appear as well for you, Alex. But they took it on board, and that's literally what we loaded up into the profiles. And all of a sudden, the machine started to do its work. And that was all the information started being generated. We started getting trade-off studies. We started really getting into the detail of it and working it out. But honestly, that from a client's point of view, the annoying client, that's really what I said. And that was really the brief for the team to work at. And then they started really grinding out the work. Now, you can imagine if I'd have said that to a traditional engineering consulting firm, they usually would laugh me out of the room, as typically they do. But the beauty of the gen design work was that it was able to actually crunch all of those numbers, because all of those many variables there, I mean, you can imagine how many people and how much analysis is required in that. So typically we'd only select 1, 2, 3 different options, and then we might run some trade-off studies. Whereas gen design, we're able to load in all of this information, all of the survey, geotech data, and then literally set it all up so that the computer knew exactly what we wanted, essentially goal seek, I guess, is a great way that I think in my little 286 brain. And we would tell the computer to do that, and off it went. So the power of that was mind-blowing to us, and the ability to also analyze lots of trade-off studies. The one example I'll give you that was really critical, for example, is that we're in the middle of the desert. We're 500 kilometers, 600 kilometers away from really good sources of rock material for our airport. We do have a local quarry there, but the quality of the rock's not so good. So you'd need to use a lot more rock. But the plus side is we'd remove thousands of trucks from our roads for safety. So in all of our examples, we had to run trade-off studies to say, show us with and without local rock, the changes to the design, changes to the NPV and the CapEx numbers, and also all the operational changes if we were to use local quarry material over the old material. I mean, that was, the computer did that in 2 days, and that would take weeks for our teams to analyze, review, and update all the net present value. That's just one example of what we had. The way we ran this trial was, let's run our traditional engineering design process as we would normally build an airport or build any piece of large infrastructure. And then let's benchmark it using gen design and do a side-by-side comparison of how good this technology actually is. So in terms of cost, the actual CapEx number that the computer developed compared to, and let me call it the human, the traditional way, was very, very close, almost the same. So that was a great, we knew we had something that could produce the right solutions. The cost associated with that, if we went the gen design model now, I think straight away we could knock 30% off that total cost of developing those engineering solutions. In terms of time, just a sort of a benchmark, it takes about 4 weeks to run one option. So that's to develop the engineering designs, review them, check them, then to produce the capital cost estimate, then to update the financial model, and then to see what the NPV would be of that. So that's just for one option. That's a typical sort of an example. Gen Design was able to do 250 options in 2 days. So that sort of hands down killed it in terms of efficiency for our teams, and the amount we could actually draw this out and really drive this technology could just optimize so much of our work. And I guess the other piece of it is that gen design is actually a really visual medium. I'm actually a bit of a visual person as well, even though engineering is my background. And I often present to, every project has to present to review boards, peer reviewers, and also for our funding boards as well. So when you're able to present the airport, the befores and afters, you're also able to show them how the airport, and you can see in some of the designs, we've slowed it down, but the computer is generating different options and opportunities. You're able to communicate how, a bit of the how of what we did, why we did it, and how we arrived at our solution, why we arrived at our solution. So that's really powerful for funding bodies and for peer reviewers to understand a bit of that journey that you took and the decisions you made. So they can understand, well, look, this business case is based on these 4, 5, 6 core fundamental issues. We can see them. And then it also opens up the conversation. I always found at a dinner party when I had a spreadsheet, no one really talked much. They all sort of, if I show my spreadsheet, it was a bit of a party pooper, if I can say that. But the moment I started talking about gen design, and you can, my parties are probably not that exciting as some of the other dinner parties. But the moment I showed gen design work, anyone could understand it. They could see an airport being built. They could see how it's aligned. And then what that allows is that easier communication, easier question making, it allows managers to make, it's just easier decision making. And that really equals for the project manager, easier delivery. So that's one of the really powerful things that we had there. The question I often ask myself is, where is this going? Where is the generative design space moving into? So if I was to think of it just as a project manager and to look at this process, for me, we would love to see it, the gen design, not just sitting in that concept early schematic design phase, but actually that you could press the button and get a full concept design that you could then sit down, show that design in models and visually discuss it with all your peer groups, show all the funding, get approval. And then you could press the button again, I'm simplifying it in my little, 286 brain, but you could press the button and then bang, out comes the preliminary design. So you've just saved yourself on an airport job. There's 6 months you've saved yourself, down from 6 months to 2 months. Again, review everything, refine it, and you press the button again and you get detailed engineering drawings, all done, dusted. And even further would be full tender documentation, all done and dusted. So really, if the process could automate all the way down the delivery line, you would have this amazing streamlined process that you'd be able to quickly execute projects, get buy-in from all our stakeholders, make sure everyone's tucked into the vision of the project and is happy with the outcomes that's going to be delivered. And then it's very much a automate the process and then deliver all the engineering drawings and at the touch of a button. So that's probably one area that I'd love to see developed. Thank you very much for having me and allowing the annoying client to have a conversation, to chat to you. Let me firstly say thank you so much for putting out this information in 2018. Had you never put it out for us to see for free, it would never have started this journey. I really want to extend that thanks to us. And we're really grateful to be part of this journey with you. And also we want to thank our engineering partner, Jacobs, very much, and all the Autodesk team that helped us.
Thank you, Aleks, for sharing your exciting story. And thanks again to Daniel. Thank you also to all of you for joining us today. I hope we've given you insights into the opportunities that are available to deliver more sustainable and resilient projects using Autodesk solutions. Autodesk is truly proud to partner with you throughout your digital transformation journey. I also want to reiterate that it's not what we do at Autodesk, but rather what you, our customers, do to change the world using our technology. So thank you and stay safe.